Welcome to ILTV's Israel Daily. I'm Lauren Izzo. And coming up in this edition, in a whirlwind tour, Mike Pompeo becomes the first acting U.S. Secretary of State to visit a West Bank settlement. Two Israeli players are selected to play in the NBA during last night's 2020 draft. And good news for immigrants to Israel. They will now be allowed to have foreign visitors, despite pandemic restrictions. U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo is in Israel for a whirlwind 10-day, seven-nation tour through Europe and the Middle East. Landing in Israel on Wednesday evening, Pompeo's last diplomatic tour before a new administration takes the White House has a jam-packed schedule. More in the next report.
With just 2 months to go until Joe Biden, the projected president-elect, takes the hot seat, the Trump administration is trying to make its mark on U.S. foreign policy. The U.S. Secretary of State landing in Israel on Wednesday evening as part of a 10-day international tour. A first for an acting U.S. Secretary of State, Pompeo visits a winery in a West Bank settlement today.
You know, today I'll get a chance to visit the Golan Heights. The simple recognition of this as part of Israel, too, was a decision President Trump made that is historically important and simply a recognition of the reality.
The Psagot Winery welcoming Pompeo after in 2019 releasing a special edition bottle of wine named in his honor. On Wednesday, the U.S. Secretary of State holding meetings and press conferences throughout the day, reinforcing the Trump administration's commitment to Israel over the last 4 years. During his visit, announcing that goods made in West Bank settlements will now be labeled Made in Israel, calling the BDS movement anti-Semitic.
During the Trump administration, America stands with Israel like never before. Indeed, the commitment we've made, the ironclad commitment we've made to the Jewish state, will continue.
Netanyahu also taking the opportunity to highlight the Iran threat and that the U.S. is standing firmly behind Israel.
Thanks to your tremendous efforts to carry out President Trump's maximum pressure campaign, Iran's feet have been held to the fire, and we have seen a reduction in the amount of support that they are given to their various proxies in the region.
They remain the foremost state sponsor of terrorism in all the world. And Israel has provided outstanding support to our pressure campaign, which we have no intention of relaxing.
The countdown until the end of Trump's 4 years has begun, and the Abraham Accords, his Middle East peace effort, is something he won't let the world forget.
These agreements also tell malign actors like the Islamic Republic of Iran that their influence in the region is waning and that they are ever more isolated in this shall forever be until they change their direction.
It's unclear if the Trump administration will concede the election anytime soon. But in the meantime, the president's still taking every opportunity to make history. Chana Rifkin, ILTV.
Okay, let's go live to Kevin Racklin. He's the U.S. director at the Alliance for Middle East Peace, and he joins us from Arlington, Virginia. Thank you, Kevin, for joining us.
Thanks for having me. Good to see you.
So, you know, with just 2 months to go until Trump's presidency will come to an end after 4 years, what exactly is the purpose of this, you know, foreign policy tour? Will there be any real policy announcements during his visit?
Well, I think we've already seen the first major policy announcement, which is the changing of the labeling policy from goods made inside the West Bank, specifically in West Bank settlements, to being described as made in Israel. And this specifically applies in the announcement around Area C, which is a massive change in U.S. policy. In addition to that, just when we're looking at Israel and Palestine as well, the fact that the Secretary of State has come to a West Bank settlement is really quite unprecedented. It's the first time a sitting Secretary of State has come to the region and come to a settlement inside the West Bank. And it really marks a shift in policy of how the U.S. Looks at the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. But I think, you know, importantly enough that, you know, this is something that they are trying to do. They're trying to go on this foreign policy tour to kind of do a last round of victories before they are out of office on January 20th. And so that's why you're seeing them visit, you know, the settlements inside the West Bank, to the Golan Heights, they're going to Qatar, this meeting with Turkey. They're trying to kind of do a last round of foreign policy victories. And I think the visit to Israel is quite significant for them as it goes to the Abraham Accords.
Well, while Netanyahu has congratulated Biden for winning the election, Trump has yet to concede. And Pompeo has even said they are looking forward to a smooth transition into a second Trump administration. How do we expect the conversation about the election to go in private between Pompeo and Netanyahu? Might be a little awkward?
I don't know if it'll be in private, it'll be as awkward. I think there is a general consensus, even privately amongst most Republicans, as well as all, you know, foreign dignitaries, that, you know, President-elect Biden will become the president on January 20th. And I think the conversation is most likely going to be around what can this outgoing administration do around Iran, and also the questions of what, you know, the Secretary Pompeo may do in beyond his term as Secretary of State if he ends up deciding to run for the Republican ticket in 2024, trying to shore up wins around that point. So I think it's a lot of, I think the main conversation will end up being around Iran, with some slight conversation around 2024.
And so, you know, what will happen to Trump's policies now once Joe Biden takes the White House? What will his legacy be, especially regarding Israel and the Middle East?
So I think there's a couple of things that you'll see when it comes to Biden around the around Trump's legacy inside Israel, inside Palestine. The first I would say is, when you're looking at the Trump peace plan, that's already a non-starter, and it's kind of been dead on arrival from the moment it was released. And there were some interesting things about that peace plan, but I think, you know, the vice president and the president-elect now has made it very clear that he is supporting a two-state solution. I think that's going to be driving a good chunk of his policies. As for the Abraham Accords, I don't see the president-elect actually rolling back any of those deals, and I think he has come out and said that he supports these normalization efforts. But I think it's really critical to kind of underscore, and I think he has done, as well as his surrogates have underscored, that normalization between the Arab states is not a solution to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, and having to redouble efforts to really try to impact that. And then finally, for things like these, the status of settlements under U.S. Policy, I think you'll start to see that shift once the president-elect is sworn in and the Secretary of State, as well as the ambassador to Israel, are selected. I think that these issues will be very will probably be switched quite quickly, simply because they go against what they view as how to produce a two-state solution.
The Trump administration very quickly cut off communication with the Palestinians, and vice versa. And Biden has not yet entered the White House, and he's already reopened that communication with the Palestinian Authority. So what are the next 4 years going to look like in terms of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict specifically?
So I think what you'll see in the first couple years is there won't be much, top-tier diplomacy when it comes to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. I think you'll see the general, you know, either a high-level surrogate or the president-elect himself going to Israel, visiting with Netanyahu, visiting with President Abbas. But in terms of like the real motivation, what's happening on the ground, the president-elect understands the gravity of what he's walking into when it comes to the relationship between the United States and the Palestinians and the Palestinian Authority. And that's going to take a long time to repair some of those relationships. So I think what you'll see is a focus on civil society, growing trust again between the U.S. and the Palestinians, as well as kind of reinforcing the relationship with Israel.
All right, well, we will be following Pompeo's whirlwind trip and also the next 2 months before Biden takes office. Kevin Racklin, thank you so much for this.
Thank you so much for having me.
Meanwhile, Bahrain's foreign minister is also in Israel, during his trip announcing a new Bahraini embassy in Israel and an Israeli embassy in Manama. Also yesterday, holding a press conference with Mike Pompeo and Netanyahu, announcing a new travel visa system that will begin December 1st. That allows travelers to apply for entry visas online.
To kick start this process, I am happy to announce that commencing from the 1st of December, the e-visa system will be implemented in both Bahrain and Israel to allow for our citizens to travel freely between the two countries.
Since the Abraham Accords have been signed, the Gulf state announced there will be 14 weekly flights between Manama and Tel Aviv. Meanwhile, the Bahraini foreign minister met with Israel's president, Reuven Rivlin, yesterday.
I make clear to the Palestinian people that Israel wants to live in peace in this region. President Abbas, we want to live in peace. We are one family. We are all sons of Abraham. Jews and Muslims, the children of Abraham, as I've said, Israelis and Palestinians are not doomed to live together. We are destined to live together. In this time, to build trust and to make peace, inshallah.
After the latest escalation, Prime Minister Netanyahu says that Israel won't tolerate any attempt of attack from Syrian territory. Israel launching air raids against what it called a wide range of Syrian and Iranian targets overnight Wednesday. Netanyahu releasing this statement on social media.
לפנות בוקר חיל האוויר תקף מטרות משמעותיות של כוח קוץ האיראני בסוריה וגם של צבא סוריה. זאת המדיניות הברורה שאני מוביל מזה שנים. לא נאפשר התבססות איראנית צבאית נגדנו בסוריה ולא נאפשר שום ניסיון של תקיפה נגדנו משטח סוריה. מי שמנסה לתקוף אותנו, מי שתוקף אותנו, דמו בראשו.
In a rare move, the IDF also launching this video of the strikes. And the Syrian Observatory for Human Rights Monitor saying at least 10 people were killed in those strikes. The IDF says that the terror cell behind the anti-personnel mines and other IEDs on the Golan Heights is Unit 840, which is being operated by the Iranian Quds Force. Israeli basketball fans rejoice. Not one, but two Israeli players are now joining the NBA. During the 2020 draft late last night, 19-year-old Denny Avdia, the ninth draft pick, was selected to play for the Washington Wizards. That makes him Israel's first ever lottery pick and second ever first rounder after Omri Kaspi, who was the 2009 NBA draft's 23rd overall pick.
I'm super excited from Washington. It's a great organization. I'm so glad, I'm so blessed to get picked by them, and I'm ready to work and to meet everybody. So, yeah.
And Yam Madar was also taken by the Boston Celtics, making it only the second time ever that two Israelis have been selected in the same draft. Let's hear more from Ynet news editor and sports junkie Liran Friedman. Hey, Liran, thanks for joining us.
Oh, it's a pleasure.
So I understand two Israeli players were drafted this morning, but there's one name that's taking over the headlines. Denny Avdia, correct? What is so special about that pick?
What we need to understand is that Denny Avdia is a phenomenon in Israeli basketball, generally in European basketball. We still need to remember that this is a 19-year-old kid, explosive, offensively oriented, can pass, can rebound, can shoot when he wants. Getting picked in the first 10 picks of the NBA draft is insane. Not to put any shade on Omri Kaspi and all those who preceded him, and of course, my personal favorite, Yam Madar, went to my Boston Celtics, but this man is maybe not only the future of Israeli basketball, but European basketball in general.
So what exactly is this guy's story? Tell me a bit about how he got started, his training, and how he wound up where he is right now.
Avdia comes from a very prominent basketball family. His dad, Zufar, was the team captain for Belgrade Red Star during the 1980s. Those who know EuroLeague basketball know that there's one team you have to always be scared of is Belgrade Red Star. His mom was also a track star, and she was a basketball player. He himself started playing at a very, very, very young age, I would say about 9 or 10. He is, to this day, the youngest player to play professionally from Maccabi Tel Aviv, getting picked by the team at 16. Two championships with the Israeli under-20 team in FIBA, 2018, 2019. 2018 got the MVP and also played in 2019 with Yam Madar. It's just all basketball. This man is best post-millennium basketball, post-2000 basketball pretty much.
Does he already have some sort of fan base outside of Israel, or is he still working to build that now that he's going to join the NBA?
He has two very interesting fan bases, so to speak. First, because he's half Serbian, he has a huge, huge following in the Balkans, especially in Serbia and Kosovo, which is where his father is from. And American basketball fans, Jewish American basketball fans, love him to death. Ever since they started talking about him being the big prospect, going to the draft, people have been losing their minds over this kid. And he proves us constantly, all of the time, that this is the big guy. This is our mensch on the bench, so to speak.
And tell me about this team he's joining. What are those players like? What's the dynamic of the Wizards, and how will he fit into that? You think he's going to do well over there?
Avdia might be the piece that they're missing right now. They might be their small forward. They need a rotation. This is a great opportunity for him to get into the lineup, really show his stuff, work on some keys that he have when it comes to free throw shooting, when it comes to general passing, and maybe a little bit grow up with his gaming mentality, but he has the chops. He has what that team needs right now
which is to rebuild, go to the playoffs, start winning more, start going up. And I think it was a good choice to take a video to do it. I think this is his future now, becoming a Washington Wizards star.
All right. Well, we'll have to watch out for this mensch on the bench and see what happens to his NBA career. Liron Friedman, thank you so much.
Thank you.
After that rare, uplifting story, during a year that seems to be full of bad news, while most of the country is still considered to be on lockdown in some capacity, the government is slowly lifting restrictions, and a vaccine could be on the way very soon. Here is Nittany Manson with the update.
It looks like we could be nearing the beginning of the end of the COVID-19 pandemic as we come close to wrapping 2020. Israel's prime minister saying we are on the right track to being among the first nations to be vaccinated.
בשורות טובות מחזית הקורונה. שלשום שוחחתי עם מנכ"ל מודרנה, סטפן בנסל, אתמול עם דוקטור טל זקס, בכיר בחברה, על חתימה, על הגדלת המספר המנות שיוקצו לאזרחי ישראל. אני מאמין שאנחנו על סף חתימה, חדשות מצוינות, בנוסף לכך שחברת פייזר, שאיתה כבר חתמנו על 8 מיליון מנות, הולכת להגיש אישור תוך ימים לרשויות הרפואה בארצות הברית כדי לספק את החיסונים האלה, ואנחנו נהיה בין הראשונים לקבלם. זה התחלת הסוף של הקורונה.
Israel's government also announcing Wednesday that for the first time since Israel closed its borders to tourists, new immigrants will be able to receive visitors, a big win for the local expat community.
Olim, this one's for you. After months of discussions and raising the imperative for holistic and transparent policy with regards to visits for Olim, I'm happy to report that today the Aliyah and Klita Committee made the final decision that Olim that have been in Israel for up to 4 years will now be able to receive visits from immediate family members. We will continue and follow up on this with hope that we can extend it to Olim that have been here for longer as well. But for now, within a month, there should be the opportunity for family, immediate family, to visit Olim that have been in Israel for up to 4 years.
Also, a special Knesset committee on Wednesday voting to reopen restaurants, trade industry, and tourist attractions in what the government calls tourism hubs, as well as zoos and safari parks throughout the country. The Tel Aviv-Yafo municipality saying, too, it will launch a season of new performances and cultural initiatives, including hundreds of events every week, while continuing to follow coronavirus regulations. And here are the latest figures. On Wednesday, Israel's health ministry recording 780 new cases. There are currently 306 in critical condition, and the death toll stands at 2,739. Nittany Manson, ILTV.
Well, I don't know about you, but when I woke up this morning, I had an email waiting for me in my inbox from HBO Max, finally announcing the release date of Gal Gadot's latest movie, Wonder Woman 1984. The film, which had its release rescheduled a handful of times because of the pandemic, finally the company announcing it will come out on Christmas Day. Gadot tweeted about the release, saying, "We feel the movie has never been more relevant, and we hope that it'll bring some joy, hope, and love to your heart." Gadot also has another big release on the way. They're calling it the Snyder Cut. Her Justice League film received mixed reviews upon its release in 2017 after the director was replaced. The original director, Zack Snyder, has re-edited the film into a four-part miniseries, according to his original vision. It will also be released on HBO Max, but in 2021, with no specific date as of yet. Moving on now, high-tech is always reaching for newer and more convenient solutions. And now, what if we could completely nix headphones and Bluetooth? Joining us now is CEO Dr. Christoph Ramstein of Israeli tech firm Noveto Systems, to talk to us about their latest 3D technology, sound beaming. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us.
It's a real pleasure to be here. Imagine a technology that gets you 3D sounds, that gets you an immersiveness that's amazing just for you. Other people wouldn't hear it. And that would happen without any wearable device on your face, any headphones. This is possible due to ultrasonic technology that are being projected next to you. And thanks to a depth sensor that tracks the position of your ears, We have the ability to create pockets of sounds next to you, moving you wherever you are and giving you 3D quality sounds that gives you an amazing immersiveness. When you do video conferencing, you can talk to someone, you hear it, but others don't. When you play games, you have the 3D sounds. When you have TVs, you have the sounds, others don't hear it. When you're driving a car, you have the ability to listen to sounds other people don't. When you're on a treadmill, you're running, listening to your best TV show and other people don't, without any headphones. That's what Noveto is about, brand new technology that is going to hit the market in December 2021.
So for somebody that, like me, that doesn't necessarily understand the nuances in this technology, what is the user experience like? What would I be feeling? How can I experience this?
So what you would be feeling is imagine invisible speakers that move next to your ears. Imagine that a second. So when you move, you have the 3D sound. So it's like imagine a lake with birds that are singing. You're literally in the middle of them. Imagine bees around you. You feel the bees, you hear them. Imagine some gunshots coming around you. Because you have those invisible pockets of sounds that are near to you, you have this very strong, powerful experience of 3D. But again, because the sounds are just next to you, someone sitting a meter away from you will only hear about 10% of what you do. So it's just for you. When you're sitting in the living room or at your desk, you watch this, you get the sound, you get this amazing kind of immersiveness. But others, a bit further away, will not hear it.
And what about the noise that's around you? Is that canceling out all the other noise so you can focus on what you're listening through these sound pockets? Or can you also hear so your surroundings?
Not today. That's on the roadmap. That's going to come next. First, what we want is really getting the ultrasound, creating sounds next to you for an experience that's never been done before. Existing traditional speakers cannot do that. Headphones cannot do it because you have to wear something. So that's the first step. Then in the future, we are going to consider adding to that noise cancellation so you can remove sounds coming from the outside. Not today, a couple of years from now, probably.
And, you know, the million-dollar question, is your company going to make headphones obsolete? Are we still going to be seeing headphones once this technology is universal?
Well, I think there is definitely something to be said about the immersiveness and augmented reality. And phones today are massively being driven by a flat screen and sound that is boring. So adding this technology to the mobile phone will definitely transform the future of the communication. Telepresence and the feeling of being in a conversation as opposed to being talking to someone is coming, and Noveto is going to make this happen.
All right, we're looking forward to it. Dr. Ramstein, thank you so much.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Well, Tel Aviv is among the top-ranked accessible cities in the world, specifically when it comes to wheelchairs. British magazine Truly Belong commending Israel's metropolitan capital for making strides in recent years, also stating that the combination of flat landscape, wheelchair-accessible beaches, buses, and even special guided group tours, as well as accommodations for the visually impaired, makes the city welcoming and easier to navigate, tourists included. Tel Aviv shares the top ranks along with other cities such as Vienna, Barcelona, and Berlin. Okay, let's take a look at the weather forecast. This weekend, expect showers starting Friday, with lows tonight averaging 59 degrees Fahrenheit and about 15 degrees Celsius. Friday and Saturday, highs will average approximately 75 degrees Fahrenheit and around 19 degrees Celsius. And now, before we go, let's take a look at what's going viral in Israel. So apparently some K-pop stars are really into Israeli music, and this video of some Korean pop stars went viral of them singing a song by Israeli musician Idan Reichel. Definitely go look it up on YouTube. It's really, really awesome. All right, that's it for today's news. Today's exchange rate is 3.35 shekels to the American dollar and 2.56 shekels to the Canadian dollar. For more news from ILTV, please like ILTV on Facebook, follow us on Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube and Roku TV pages. I'm Lauren Izzo. Thanks so much for watching.